Right.
Come on.
As a team.
You're ready.
Have a look in. Look in. See what you're going in against. And the team look in.
Newbold Revel Prison Service College near Rugby in Warwickshire, where half a dozen times a year, nearly 200 NEPOs, new entry prison officers, assemble for a 9-week training course. 1 in 18 who apply get this far. This film is following 3 of them.
Room number is St. Cecilia's, room 104. Once you find
your... I wanted to join the prison service because I thought it was a secure career, and I'd fancied doing it since I was a lot younger, and I thought it was... Now I was 34, I was mature enough to take it on.
Tom Gill is a Geordie, a family man, and has come down from Durham. Diane Dean is also married. She's 23 and from London.
I just enjoy working with people. And I couldn't think of another job where you work more with people. One of my sisters, she asked me why I couldn't get a normal job because I left the army and joined the prison service. You know, they're both secretaries. I think that's what they class as normal jobs.
Tracksuit top, tracksuit bottom. Okay, if you just go a bit further along there, pick yourself a judo trouser.
The options I was looking at were like in the discipline type of service. There was ambulance, fire brigade, the police. And I got all the information together and prison service looked the best choice.
Take yourself a bottom through there.
Tony Withers, a Brummie, and at 21, the youngest of the three, has previously been an ophthalmic nurse and a security guard.
Solid 11, no chance.
First of all, welcome to Newbold Revel. It's an opportunity, I think, for us to meet very quickly before the course starts proper, just to break the ice and to identify ourselves. In that vein, myself, Ian Simmons, Governor 4. On my left, Mel Orton, Principal Officer Tutor. And on the far left, Les Sunshine, also a Principal Officer Tutor. We comprise the tutorial team for I section, NR6.
Begin! 1, 2, 3, 4.
If someone can't run 50 to 100 yards quickly to answer an alarm bell, etc., they're going to be no good to themselves, no good to colleagues. So certainly heart and lung fitness is important. It's something that I believe is lacking a little bit in the service, in that ongoing fitness training for staff is not made as important as it should be.
Stop! Sit down!
How was it? No worries.
Yeah, no worries.
Half past
6, 7, 7. That's good.
Bearing in mind where the vacancies are, as far as possible, and I've actually sat on a postings board, they're not inhumane as people may think. They will genuinely try and match your preferences up with the vacancies. But there may well be people in this room who will not get the posting of their choice. I'm not saying that's inevitable, but it's possible. Because you must give the postings board a chance to choose for you, as well as you stating your preference. So, Brixton, Wandsworth, Pentonville, if you want to go to London, North East, Accrington, Durham, Frankland. If you want East Anglia, Norwich, Blunderstone, Holsley Bay. Give them the choices.
I've chosen Durham, Frankland, Lower Newton because I'm nearly 34 and I've lived in the Durham area all my life. My wife's lived in the Durham area all of her life. My two children go to school in the Durham area. My wife's parents are both retired, and, you know, we're calling on them a lot.
I'm looking for a local prison, that's my main thing. And from the directions of what we've been told all the way through the course, right from the beginning, if you're single, all right, I know what we've been told, but if you're single, there's a very good chance you're going to go down to London, because that's where they need them. That's where they're desperately short. And I've been looking into Brixton. It's not a great area to live, but it's a damn good prison to work at.
Hopefully I'll get Holloway. Obvious reasons that I'm a Londoner. It's where my family are, it's where my husband is. And no, I think it'd be a good posting. I mean, it's an enormous place and they've got everything there. It's where I did my Nepo in as well for 3 weeks. And I think you could sort of learn anything you need to know there.
Many of the Nepos, like Diane Dean, are from the armed forces and find drill almost second nature.
Listen to my words of command. High section, stand not! Height! Stand easy. I'm a Scott Ollicle with me.
But for a former sheet metal worker from the northeast, it's another matter.
Move them to the left in threes and march them up towards the barrier, yes? Left wheel them and head them straight towards the main gates of the parade ground, yes? Maintaining control and command at all times. Okay, you going to do that for me?
Sure I can do.
Certainly will, sir, or you'll do it again. Right, come on, it's all yours. Stand to attention before I give the order.
High section! Shit! Move to the left in threes! Left, turn! Quick march! Left, right, left, right, left! Left! Left!
Drill isn't meant to be like turning people out as Coal Street guardsmen. It's more instilling self-discipline, bringing people together as a group. But the more important aspect is, of course, as I say, to actually get the weaker members to actually project themselves more in simple, basic words of command.
Right, sir. Halt them from here, sir. On the right foot! Wrong, as you were. You got a cautionary word of command. I section, halt. Then they know what you're going to do. Start them off again. By the left, quick march. Come on.
By the left, quick march.
Always be suspicious. Every rub-down search is a new rub-down search for you. Every rub-down search for that inmate is the first time he's had it, as far as you're concerned.
In the classroom, the Nepos spend an intensive 4 weeks on an interpersonal skills package. They learn assertion, body language, and basic prisoner psychology.
What's the areas that we're going to look at first of all, then?
Head.
Ears.
Ears.
Mouth.
Nape of the neck.
Nape of the neck. Where are we going from a neck?
Collar.
Shoulders.
Using what are, for some, newly acquired skills, the recruits have to carry out a top-to-toe search of some difficult and very vocal inmates, at all times avoiding confrontation.
You want my shoes off, boss?
No, keep them on.
Take them off.
No, keep them on. Keep them on.
What would we do if we find one with a bandage on?
Hospital officer. Hospital officer, ask him if he's put it on.
Short of a strip search, the rub-down, an everyday occurrence in England's jails, is the quickest and, conducted properly, the most practical way of searching a prisoner.
What do we do if we got one with a lot of horrible, lank, scruffy hair?
Search it.
Just hope it don't move while you've got your hands in it.
That's right. Long hair, we're going over it for a reason. It's got to be businesslike, okay? So you start off, particularly long hair, look under the nape of the neck because it's a lovely place to do things. You're not doing it to mess my hair up, you're actually doing to see if I've concealed anything.
It's a lesson in control and sensitivity. The wrong move with a touchy inmate, real or imagined, can lead to trouble.
Okay, if you're taking it off, What were we doing with the jacket? We went all through it. The first thing I said was inspect the inside.
That's right, yeah.
Then turn off pockets. Now put your hand in the pocket.
Yeah.
I really wasn't concealing it.
It wasn't too much of a failure for most of you on interpersonal skills. You'd got the basics. Aware of the proximity, personal space, eye contact, assertion. You were in charge.
the basic technical skills of a rubdown search. But nevertheless, you still get a sense of failure. Believe you me, in this service, you'll get more of a sense of failure most of the time you do success.
You've just been detailed C1 landed in HMP Newbold.
Newbold Revel has its own landing, with cells and doors like those found in prisons up and down the country. And while all the students have spent a fortnight observing prison officers in a jail near their homes before joining the course, this is their first hands-on experience.
All right, sir. There's your landing. There's your prisoners.
Thank you, sir. Right. Roll check then, Mr. Lewis.
People assume that locking and unlocking a door is quite a straightforward exercise, but in most cases it demands a bit more than that in prisons.
I'm sorry, concerned got turns 8, should be 9.
Bearing in mind that behind cell doors, particularly in the morning, might well be prisoners who are tetchy, grumbly, sleepy, nasty, aggressive. Having dwelt on problems for the most of the night, having had perhaps a bad experience the day before. So prison officers need to be aware of all these difficulties when they're unlocking the cell doors, particularly in the morning. Most of the time you'll find that prisoners will know the routine as much as the staff do. And you won't have to keep shouting, come along, come along. Most of them will have done it anyway. It's a routine, a daily routine for them. So the odd one you might have to hurry up, yes. You know, there's always a slow coach. But for the most part, everybody will do exactly what they're supposed to do, what they're expected to do. But there again, you're being trained to look for the unexpected, aren't you? Aren't you?
Clear the fingers. Good, that's good.
Once a reasonable level of general fitness has been achieved in the gym, the recruits move on to more physical techniques of controlling violent prisoners.
Okay?
Yes.
And we're going to sit you up, right? Yeah, otherwise you're going to feel some ultimate pain.
Some what?
Right, bring your knees up to your chest.
By practicing control and restraint techniques on each other, they quickly learn just how much pressure needs to be applied and when the lock begins to hurt. Incidentally, it's said to be impossible to break someone's wrist bending it like this.
No, I've got to.
I'll get him to
explain. Okay. Here we go.
Bend your arms down. That's good. Keep him well and truly trapped in there. That's good. You keep too much pressure on, this guy is going to blow, isn't he? We call it control and restraint, remember. Not only restraining the prisoner, but showing restraint ourselves. We've got away from the good old days where we all used to jump in and stomp all over these people. That's out a long time ago. What we're doing now is we're handling these people in a humane way. And if you think that by keeping that pressure on all the time is a good way, you're going to learn by that fault. Because the guy will blow. Already, I've seen it in your faces now, that ultimate's been on far too long, and there's nothing left then, is there? Once that pain's there, you're going to have to go. So ease down. If he starts to move wrongly, then we go back into pressure. Then we go back to comfortable pain. Then back into pressure. Okay, and you can keep the lid on a situation by doing that, by easing that pain up and down. But I'm sure that all of you have been prisoners. When you get up in that position, you really find now that you're well wrapped up, aren't you? There's not much you can do. You can't swing at anybody. You can't butt anybody. You can't kick anybody. And that's what we're looking for in this situation.
The use of force by a prison officer in dealing with a prisoner is governed by Rule 44. An officer in dealing with a prisoner should not use force unnecessarily. And when the application of force to a prisoner is necessary, no more force than is necessary shall be used. And you will strictly adhere to that. What you've got to bear in mind, if you need to use force, one hit is lawful, the second hit is unlawful. Now, let's get down to the nitty-gritty. How do we draw a stake if our mate says so? Our mate? Senior officer on duty. Right, lads, draw your stakes, we're going in. So how do we draw our stake? We don't just get it out like that, do we?
We take the thumb through the strap, wind the strap around the back of the hand, and it falls into one's fingers. You can caress it. One caresses it, and it falls into the hand. Are you listening to me? Thank you. It falls into the hand and is now ready. Anybody wants to try to pull it from you? They're pulling against, are they not? If we try to do it clever, like that, it's gone. It is then theirs and not yours. They can then caress it. So, it's through, round and in. Once more. Through, round and in, and it's there. Fractions of a second and it's in your hand. I want a person from each group to come up and collect a card. That card will have a person or a type of person or a stereotype person on it. The person who selects the card, I want to go back to the group and defend that position. And then I want the others in that group to mount the most prejudiced attack they can, verbally, not physically, verbally against that person.
During the course, there are 9 45-minute classes on race relations. There are an equal number on riot control.
You're on the dole, and I know it.
I'm not on the dole. I'm a tinker, sir.
Continental
look, sir.
Plates on.
Look, sir. I sharpen a knife. I sharpen a knife. I do frogs. I mend cars.
He's a gypsy.
That's all I do.
Actually, he can't be a tinker. They look down. Gypsies look down on tinkers, don't they?
Do they? I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, he's a gypsy tinker, then. I look down on this bloke, whatever.
All we asked the council for was a couple of skips so we could put all the rubbish in. They won't give it to us.
It's still green.
We've got to it.
Yeah, the
of course it would, because if they give us skips, we could then just lift it up and take it away. No problem at all, but you won't, because you're so prejudiced against us.
You have all the cars in the average gypsy these days.
What, you mean the broken-down truck?
A broken-down truck to let the stuff in, and they go home in a morning.
The Home Office wants to eradicate prejudice in the prison service. The tutors, however, accept that in the time available, they can do little to change the attitudes of a lifetime.
The prison department is committed absolutely to a policy of racial equality and to the elimination of discrimination in all aspects of the work of the prison service. It is opposed also to any display of racial prejudice, either by word or conduct, by any member of the service in his or her dealings with any other person.
During the first few weeks of the course, the new recruits had to detail the prisons they wanted to work at when they qualified. Due to find out where that would be halfway through the course, postings day was delayed, mainly because of the implementation of the government's Fresh Start Pay and Overtime initiative. With just 2 weeks of the course left, the day has finally arrived. At the back of everyone's mind, the fact that the Home Office recruits nationally, and new officers know from the outset that when all is said and done, they have to go where they're needed.
All stand.
24, sir.
Thank you. Sit down, ladies and gentlemen.
My legs are going to check.
The moment you've all been waiting for, I guess.
Like Christmas. Don't open them yet.
Don't open them yet.
So, heart's consent, Mr. Warman. Have we got one for you?
No, it's all right. Don't worry about it. I'll have a pick of my choice.
Okay. Mr. Withers.
Thank you.
Mr. Pinfold, is it?
Yes.
Hi, Mrs. McGuire. Mr. Cadwallader. Lewis, Mr. Tomlinson, have you all got one?
Sir. Yes.
Anybody not got one?
May now open your
arm. Yeah, no, we've
got. Oh. Only.
Stop. Who is that?
Where are you
got? About 10 miles down the road.
Rochester, sir. Where's Rochester, sir?
Oh, my God.
The Midway Tower.
Tony Withers, like Tom Gill, has also been posted to Rochester. Diane Dean, as expected, to Holloway.
Guys, if you can just settle down for a minute, please. Rochester does figure quite heavily, as I understand it from having talked to Mr. Shaw, who was on the postings board. The fresh start complementing of Rochester had a considerable effect on this postings board. I think there are something like 21 people on the course going to Rochester.
Where is it, Tom?
73. I've got a clue. Where's it at?
I think it's doing the somewhere.
What's Rochester come under? 100 and something.
Where are we, Tom?
Tom here.
In the walled garden of the former stately home, the trainees learn the use of body belts. This medieval-looking device is used to prevent prisoners damaging themselves, prison officers, or prison property.
Has that gone into your thing?
Squeal, look at this.
Suck your stomach in.
Enjoy your lunch.
You should have unscrewed that before.
Yeah, I know.
Let's click it. Okay.
I think I spun it round.
Yeah.
Okay, boss.
You win. You're off this time, boss.
Don't forget, Mr. Wood, the hands, palms facing the sides.
Okay, Mr.
That's it. Right in.
Bloody fat.
Put
it down a bit lower. That's the one.
Ironically, on the same day as the postings news, a session on suicide prevention with team leader Ian Simmons.
All prison staff have a professional duty to try to prevent inmates from killing themselves, regardless of who the inmates are or why they've been imprisoned. Right. There are certain people that you may feel are extremely worthless as human beings, utterly despicable, evil, nasty, and you might harbour feelings that if they were to try and commit suicide, then good luck to them. But we're professional people, are we not? We use that word care, which some people, even now in the service, tend to stay away from, because caring seems sort of implies a rather soft approach. Not one bit of it.
Get him out, Barry!
Get back, man! Go on, man!
Well done, man.
I didn't expect to be posted so far away from home, to the other end of the country, being a married man, two kids, and my own house, and just the prices. Just can't see it anywhere that I can afford to live in the posting that I've got. And that's the top and bottom. I just can't afford to live in the area where they've posted me to.
Go in, arm yourself with a rifle and bayonet, and let's have it out.
Serious disturbances are not unheard of in Britain's jails, and the recruits have to be trained to deal with them. The MUFTI, Minimum Use of Force Tactical Intervention Team, is the current Home Office solution, and in the absence of rifle and bayonet, usually sufficient for most situations.
Good one. Get some clothes on, man. I can't put much on it this day, can I?
Yeah, you should put the Velcro through.
It goes on your arms.
Yeah, that pull it tight and then Velcro back on.
I don't play cricket.
Is it useless?
It's the Mark 1 version. At this stage, a warning, yes? A verbal warning would be given to the prisoners to disperse, yes? And the warning would be something like this. Prisoners at the barricade! Climb down from the barricade, disperse and return to your landings. Failing to do so, I will be forced to use force against you. And the answer will be... What will the answer be?
Piss off, hey, sir! Right.
So I've been told in no uncertain manner what to do. Number one section, advance! Number one section, charge! Number two section! Number two section, charge!
Police team, number one section, charge! Two section, charge! Three section, advance!
Women recruits, currently numbering about one in four entrants, don't take part in the training.
I've looked at the course and we do interpersonal skills and helping, and then we end up putting the man on report, and at the end we end up hitting him with a stick. I don't know. But it's just part of the prison system, isn't it? You know, with a bit of luck, the interpersonal skills will prevent this from happening. If the guys know how to deal with people, then maybe this won't be necessary.
Control and restraint sessions in the gymnasium prepare the recruits for a final bruising exercise, where a team of three remove armed and dangerous inmates from their cell. Tony Withers has volunteered for a fight he can't win, even though he has the big stick and the team merely a shield and protective clothing. In a prison, the subdued inmate would, in all probability, spend some time in the segregation wing or block. At Newbold Revel, the corridor serves the same purpose.
We're going to put your arm behind your back, right? If there's no pain if you be quiet. Right, go on, bury it here. Nice and steady. Lift the shoulder a bit. Door clear!
Door clear!
Every cell removal is followed by an instant debriefing.
Come on, let everybody in, sit down, let's have a quick chat about that. Got a golfer lead. So the teams were well prepared outside. You kicked the door open. All right, great. Kick the door open. Get inside the door. The team went in well behind you. When you did go in, you felt them there. From where I could see, from behind you, you tend to go in at 90 mile an hour again, right? Going in too quick. You know you can take a bit of flak, right? Take a bit of flak, then get him back, right? Get him back again.
What he was doing with you were the shield man, weren't
you? Yeah.
Okay, he was just twisting the shield either way like this. Great opportunity for, first of all, somebody to shout weapon gun, the first person to see that they actually ditched their weapon. And second of all, his arms are there, the two and three should have been round and on them arms very, very quickly indeed.
you need to get over the top and secure him. Because once his legs were secured, then he quieted down. You had less problem on the upper part of the body when the legs are secure. Right, so make sure if you're the leg man, go in and secure the bloody legs. Don't just catch hold of one ankle. Get hold of both of them. Squeeze them together. Work your way up. And we want from the knee up to the waist secured. Once you've got the wrist locks on him, talk to him. You have plenty of verbal going on because he was giving you a lot of verbal. I'm not interested in him because we're not training inmates. We're training staff. All right.
Right, Mr. Gill, Turkish poses. Just face me as you are. Thank you.
Personal assessment. This is what Mr. Sunshine and Mr. Orton have written about you. Mr. Gill, after a hesitant start to the course, quickly came to terms with what was required of him. Enthusiastic during all classroom sessions, contributing well during classroom debate, he has a pleasing personality, establishing himself as a popular member of the group. Mr. Gill has put 100% effort into the course and emerges as an officer with good potential and will be an asset to any establishment. I would have you on my staff any time.
Thank you, sir.
Two shots, Mr. Dean, just as you are.
Mr. Orton and Mr. Sunshine have written a personal assessment. Mrs. Dean, ex-Armed Forces, has worked very well on the course and has returned a creditable performance. Initially presented herself as an unyielding, no-nonsense individual who would take any task that was set. As the course progressed, she settled down, offering a more realistic approach. She is a lively, outgoing personality who became an extremely popular member of the group. While able to contribute in all areas of training, I have no doubt that she will succeed in the service and give good value for money.
Turk's post says, just as you are.
Mr. Withers has worked well throughout the course, more than willing to contribute and enter into classroom debate. His comments and opinions were not given lightly, giving thought before expressing himself to the group. However, he still considered most situations black and white, with ready-made solutions easily available. Mr. Withers will mature within the service and soon come to terms with what is expected of him. He has been enthusiastic in his approach to all subjects, and if he maintains his present momentum, I'm sure he will give value for money in his chosen career.
You're going to Rochester, yes? In a fortnight's time you'll be there. Young kids are very, very, very difficult to work with. There is a tremendous area of grey. You've got to be able to think quickly on your feet. You can't go to the drawer and get the answer out. All right, it's up there. But just watch the other staff, watch the more senior staff, and move along at the pace that they're moving.
They're going into a very volatile, dangerous environment, some of them. And when all is said and done, we can prepare them as much as possible to deal with those dangerous and difficult and disturbed prisoners. But when the chips are down, it's down to the individual himself. And it's at that point that the individual has to take over based on what we've taught. But there is no final guarantee. Most of them will cope extremely well.
D1, C1. Well, D3, D0, but I'm mostly D1, C1.
2 years on, Diane Dean recalls her first days at Holloway.
It's like anything, no matter what you learn down written on paper, it's never the same when you go out and do it for real. Initially, you have a two-week induction course.
Can you keep up?
So when you come back, you have 2 weeks basically of seeing all around the prison, getting some sense of direction, not a lot in this place. And generally just watching what goes on. It's a bit of a blur, really. You don't take anything on day one.
Yeah, round to that door down there.
Tony Withers is still at Rochester Prison, having since further trained as a hospital officer.
Well, the training officer basically issued us with the sticks, told us what wings we were going to be allocated to, etc. I can't even remember the wing I was allocated to because they were rather crafty. They knew that I'd had some nursing experience, and there was disciplined officers needed to cover for the lack of hospital officers in the hospital. So they put me straight near enough within a couple of weeks into the hospital.
We are having nothing to do with our treatment, Cuff. It's a letter that I received.
Tom Gill did go to Rochester, applying for a transfer to the north. He's now back in Durham at Frankland Prison, where he admits that Rochester taught him a lot.
You'd never ever talk to a prisoner, basically. You never had conversations with them, you know. You'd seen them on your Newbold training, seen one or two, but you'd never actually been opening the doors and face to face with them. You just got on with it. There was a lot of good staff down there, older members of staff.
Come on, Cootie.
And as we were told at the school, just watch the older members and staff and how they go on.
I got eight, Jamie.
It's generally the case that women are imprisoned for more serious offences than men, so fueling the myth that they're all either mad or bad.
What's the Camden Town murder?
Yeah, that's not what's a Camden Town murder.
Yeah, I've got this one.
It's Titanic.
That's supposed to be good.
Titanic's a true story about that ship that went down years ago. She split
it
in half, didn't she?
Is it?
Well, sort of, isn't it?
They're not all mad and bad. Obviously, you get some. But they're just like everybody outside, really. You know, you just get a complete cross-section of people. You can't put a label on them, you know, just bad or mad. They're just the same as you and me, but they're in here. You know, I laugh and joke with them, but they know that if they overstep the mark, that I'll put them on report. I won't think twice. And they know that, so they, you know, they stay within the line, normally.
Ain't we got any bowls?
Yeah.
I was going to say, I thought...
What's pudding?
You want to...
No, I'm on a diet.
You've got your workforce. We also hold, I think, a few more convicted than we actually should because there's nowhere to put them. And remands are sometimes often here longer on remand than they are actually once they're sentenced. So you get to know them fairly well. It depends where you work in the prison. If you stay in one place, then obviously you get to know people.
Five, six, seven, eight, nine. I've got nine off to private spends. Mew? Yeah? Nine off, all right.
Well, if there's an alarm bell, it is difficult, or you've got a fair distance to go through curves and through so many doors to actually arrive where it is. I mean, I wouldn't know if incidents just happen because of the layout of the prison. They may happen in all prisons. But it is difficult because you've got so many doors and, like, different routes you've got to take to get somewhere. It's just one big building of bends and nooks and crannies where people will go and you can't see them.
Yeah, what colour is it? Same green as well, or not?
I should either do it green or red. I think it looks yucky if you get too many different colours on.
6 months of training in psychiatric and general nursing care at Liverpool Prison further prepared Tony Withers for the job of hospital officer. Many of his charges are in for observation. Others have attempted suicide or need treatment for drug and solvent abuse. There is a good deal of association, and occupational therapy also plays its part.
You can do something constructive.
We've had some masterpieces.
So what? Jan, yeah. What about Tony?
I get on fine if they're genuine. I have difficulty coping with the ones that I know or I feel and everybody feels are bullshitting. I don't suffer them easily. We've got lads in here that are genuinely mentally ill who've got a problem. Fair enough. But the ones that are putting it on to get advantages, I don't suffer them easily.
England's first Borstal institution and latterly a youth custody centre, Rochester has just taken in its first adult inmates.
When we have situations where medical emergencies arise, such as somebody slashing the wrists, trying to hang themselves, I know it sounds very morbid, but then you can actually feel you're of use. Other than that, and you can often feel like a pill pusher, you're downstairs, the doctor writes out a prescription, they come back day after day after day, and you're doing that all day if you're down on the treatment room. Broken up occasionally with a nice bit of interesting work.
And I did pass the stone, I think. I passed a lot of blood for a day.
Uh-huh. Well, if you discuss that with the doctor and see the doctor, what happens is the doctor wants to see you at the end of the reviewed treatment each week. Reviewed today. If you take that card, take it around the front, and the doctor will review your treatment. Come back here and we'll give you whatever you need in possession. Okay, if you go around the front.
Next.
Generally speaking, it's a routine giving out pills, recording. But the important thing, which Tony's got to, everybody's got to come to terms with, but Tony particularly, is that these jobs have got to be done properly. Once you've got those done, once you've got the routine tasks out of the way, then you can get on and do the nicer aspects of the job.
One of those routines is to see every new arrival at the prison day or night. Some, if transferred from another establishment, come with a medical file. Most, particularly remand prisoners, are unknown quantities. If there's any doubt about their medical condition, they often end up in the hospital.
Right, you come with me, I'll show you where you are situated.
Where you're dealing with large numbers of inmates, travelling through, coming in, going to being kept for 2 or 3 weeks, going to court, returning, it's the old sausage machine type of remand prison. It will mitigate against getting any long-term lasting relationships. Having said that, there is still the opportunity for people to properly care for other people in a prison setting.
At the moment, you're the only person on the ward, which I'm sure will be remedied soon. Why we're having you on the ward, the simple reason is that because of your past history, psychiatric history, we want to put you in here for observation, OK? All right. And you've actually seen a psychiatrist about your problems, then?
Yeah, 4 months.
4 months. You were in hospital for 4 months. What hospital was that?
Chase Farm.
Where?
Chase Farm.
Chase Farm. Right, that's in Enfield. Mm. OK. Right, take a seat here for a minute.
Right.
You'll be down on association. I'm going to book you on there, if you just happen to. So are you a vegetarian, or
no,
anything silly like that?
Kosher diet.
Kosher?
Yeah, Jewish.
Jewish kosher diet, right? We'll be back to talk in a minute.
It doesn't take very long for a good, intelligent hospital officer who's had his basic training to learn from more senior officers to distinguish between those who are trying it on and those who are not. But again, established medical procedures are the only safe way. When a boy reports sick with a specific symptom, he should be examined in accordance with established medical procedures. And when everything is negative, by that time, most hospital officers with some experience begin to detect the so-called malingerer.
Jesus wept.
What'd
you do that with? Razor blade. It was right down. I had to remove the one we're doing him. We're removing tissue from it. You literally cut a wedge, didn't you?
Yeah.
Like a V-shaped wedge.
In the first instance, they have to be patient, because the behaviour of any healthy senior 17-year-old can be rather trying to an adult, even without coming from an inmate. Secondly, they have to be very, very wary that inmates are not, in fact, perhaps a danger to themselves. I don't mean that they are invariably suicidal, but they make parasuicidal gestures which have to be taken seriously. Now, the only way you can do that is to have a very well laid down plan for any inmate who shows the slightest tendency towards indulging in self-harm.
Okay.
And these procedures have to be followed in every case if you're going to avoid tragedies of suicide, whether intended or not.
Rambo, one back on, French back on.
Frankland, one of the first purpose-built maximum security jails, holds some 300 prisoners from all over the country. With considerable movement around the prison, in and out of workshops, the rubdown search is part of Tom Gill's daily routine.
So, Jeff.
Prisoners here don't share cells. There's integral sanitation, and they don't undergo the degrading practice of slopping out. But facing long sentences in dull surroundings, often a long way from home and family, brings its pressures and tensions.
Is it a dangerous job? Well, it's, if you look at the inmates we have in here, if you look at it like that, you wouldn't be in the job. It could be, you know, volatile situations, it could be, but you don't, you know, you don't think about that. That's at the back of your mind. I wouldn't come in here if I thought I was going to come in here and I was put myself in jeopardy every day. I've got a wife and kids to think about.
All right, then.
With some inmates at Frankland serving over 30 years for their crimes, escape attempts are always a possibility. With security paramount, a routine like the cell search demands considerable lightness of touch.
Good spin, fella. I don't think there is any set pattern of dealing with inmates. You've got to take every inmate as you find them. If you just like to stand outside.
Do you want to talk?
There are certain ones you can't, you know, you can't talk to at certain times. You've just got to leave them. But there is ones that you know that you can talk to, and then if they go quiet on you, you have a tendency to say to them, what's the matter? Is there something the matter? You could have troubles at home and, you know, things like this. So you've just got to really play it by ear and just go along. Most of them know we're just in here doing a job. They know they're in here for what they've done. And no, you just get on with them day to day and that's it. There's no real animosity from most of them.
It's a weird situation. And at first, they're pretty much like ordinary people. But as the weeks go by and the system sets in, They change. It's an entirely different entity. The only sense of responsibility is towards themselves and towards the security of their own jobs. Anything above and beyond that, they're not interested. You know, they come in, they walk up and down the landings, turning keys all day long, and that's as far as the responsibility goes. You know, a job well done type of thing.
I think they do a lot more than watching them. That's their primary role, obviously. Our primary role is containment, because we're a top security prison. But we like to think that we offer the opportunity to inmates for self-improvement. And, for example, apart from offering things such as gymnasium and education, we're just setting up a personal officer scheme, of which Tom Gill will be a part, in the hope that we'll get officers closer to inmates and their domestic problems.
There is some who are all right, they'll laugh and joke with you and let on to you. But there are others, they can't wait to get your door shut. But they are the ones who are usually put on with new screws so they can show them the ropes. But they show them everything that they do. And it rubs off onto the younger ones. So it all just carries on then. So you've got a new generation of what we call dog screws coming up. You know, and it just repeats itself all the time.
The view from the other side of the door is depressing, more so because it points the finger of blame at the system rather than the individual prison officer. So 2 years on, do they feel they've made the right decision?
I came into this job thinking that 70-80% of the people that were in here, the inmates, were horrible, nasty individuals. I was hoping that I was going to change my mind on that, but I still feel that 80% of the inmates in here are not only here because of their circumstances, but because they are nasty individuals anyway. There are 20% who should be dealt with, should be sorted out by the community, but the other 80% are here, I feel, simply for their attitude and their greed.
Take it with some water.
I can remember being told this, that I shouldn't see things so much in black and white. Well, I think the only way you can survive in this job is to see things in black and white, because otherwise it would drive you around the bend.
You have good days, you have bad days, but overall, Holloway's a good place to be, I think. Because I don't mind being in London, that's a lot of what people have got against Holloway, is that it is in London. I enjoy it. You can learn a lot if you want to. And it's just interesting. It is good, yes.
Yeah, I should have done it a long time ago. It's the best move I've made for a lot of years, apart from the day I got posted to Rochester.